you say what you want to say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I want to see you be brave. What you want to say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I want to see you be brave. I just want to see you. I just want to see you.
Welcome to Slow Talk. My name is Dov Rudnick. Today, my guest is Robin Lithgow. Robin is the author of a new book called The Generation of Genius, which looks at the education system that gave rise to the golden age of Elizabethan theater. Robin also happens to be my mother and played an enormous role in my own intellectual growth. So without further ado, I give you Robin Lithgow. Miss Robin Lithgow, mother.
Hello, son.
Hello. I want to start with asking you a personal question. After 30-something years in the classroom and 15 years or so as an administrator, why did you feel compelled to write this book? How did you come to write this book, Generation of Genius, or whatever its final title will be when it's published?
I'm probably the only person in the world who could have written it, I think. I grew up, it was kind of a convergence of two tracks of my life. I had the incredible good fortune to grow up with my father, who produced the entire canon in the 50s, and so me between the ages of 7 and 14.
The canon of Shakespeare's plays. Yeah, all 37 plays?
Yeah, I saw every single play. And that he would do, he was kind of amazing. He would do 7 or 8 plays every summer in repertory. He would produce one per week and then run them in repertory for 3 weeks. And when people said, how could you do that? How could you possibly do that? He said, well, nobody ever told us we couldn't. And he got really fantastic talent who were young and dying to do classical theater. And they would learn the parts before they came. And just he would stagger it. So you weren't playing Othello. If you were playing Othello in 1 week, you were playing the third messenger the next week, you know. So the actors staggered their roles, so they weren't having, you know, they weren't the star of every show. And they pulled it off, and the plays were really vibrant. I think they were incredibly fresh. In my memory, they were just steaming hot, exciting. So my dad was famous for putting an egg timer on the stage and saying, if this timer is out before the scene is over, get off the stage. So it was a very, very fast-paced, very rapid. And and I know, you know, I prefer Shakespeare at high speed.
Yeah.
And I had no trouble following the language because it was so well spoken that I could get the gist of the scenes. But, you know, when I was very young, it was the funny characters that I loved. So
is your personal experience growing up in a Shakespearean family?
Yeah.
And what was the second track?
And being a teacher. And, you know, early on being a teacher, I didn't bring live theater into my teaching. But the more I did, the more vibrant my teaching was. I mean, I brought my own experience into teaching, the more vibrant my teaching was. And I taught for many, many years. And by the end of my career, I was using theater all the time. But in English classes and in any class, I mean, I was always having kids get up and perform. I also taught drama. You know, I taught in a small high school where I had several different courses that
preps.
I taught.
Preps. Yeah. I hear you talk about your book as though it's for a specialist academic subclass of some scholarly field. My impression is that it has a very broad appeal. And so I'd like to sort of talk to the broadest possible audience and ask you, why do the works of William Shakespeare matter some, 450 years later? Why does Shakespeare matter? Why does he belong in the modern curriculum? Do his plays belong in the modern curriculum?
Okay, well, first of all, when you say, I didn't write the book for academics. Truth is, I did not. I wrote it for practitioners, for teachers, specifically high school teachers and elementary school teachers, because I think that Shakespeare should be part of the curriculum, that not necessarily Shakespeare, but elevated language, beautiful language, powerful, dramatic language should be part of the curriculum, always. And so Shakespeare, of course, fits the bill for that. Propulsive language, language that takes you into a world of imagination, takes you directly into a world of imagination. That's my passion as a teacher. And nobody does that better than Shakespeare or Melville. I mean, there's wonderful writers to pull from. The second part of that question was why
does Shakespeare matter?
Why does Shakespeare matter? Well, I mean, he matters to me passionately because he's part of my upbringing. Why does he matter to the world? Why does he keep coming back and back and back, and Johnson doesn't and Marlowe doesn't? And what was it so specific about that one man that we can't seem to let go of him? I just think there was a time when I thought he was beyond imagination brilliant. I thought he was genius beyond genius. I don't think that anymore. I think that he was trained in school in rhetoric, and nobody made better use of his training in rhetoric. And rhetoric is an absolutely powerful, powerful way of using language. You know, the more you understand of how rhetorical figures figure into persuasive language, the more you sense its power. And that's why I think his language is eternal. I don't think we'll ever lose it. I mean, I feel the same way, frankly, about, never mind.
Well, I have to ask, you talk about the duration of Shakespeare and his influence. I read Shakespeare in my AP English course. I think we read a couple plays. I know we read Julius Caesar. And certainly Shakespeare was recognized as this, you know, great author. But one thing I was surprised at when I became a teacher myself and when I went through my credential program is that there was this sort of downplaying of Shakespeare as a relevant author, and even some kind of cynicism towards his works as being sort of elitist and of the dominant culture. Mm-hmm. So Shakespeare represented the values or the aesthetic of a dominant culture. And maybe it's because I'm your son, but I had a sort of revulsion to this growing, these things that I would hear from other teachers, from some professors. It wasn't universal, but it would just kind of peep up. And then just the other day in the New York Times, they interviewed a author who taught at Harvard, and she said, "I was aghast to find out that less than half of my students had actually read a Shakespeare play." Mm-hmm. These are Harvard students. These are kids who probably all took AP English.
Well, can I jump in?
Please.
I hated Julius Caesar for many, many years because I had to read it in high school. Now, I had grown up with Shakespeare, but I hated reading it. It's not supposed to be read. And when I taught Shakespeare, I would hand out whatever it was, Romeo and Juliet, King Lear, Hamlet, and I would say, "I forbid you to read this play. We're not going to read this play. We're going to bring it alive scene by scene, and maybe not do every scene, but we're going to bring it alive by speaking it." Shakespeare is supposed to be heard, not read. I hate reading Shakespeare. To this day, do not make me sit down and read a play, unless I'm reading it aloud, in which case I'm perfectly happy, because I can hear the language in my head, and it's wonderful. So that's one thing that distinguished me from most English teachers. Of course, I would have students, like I remember one marvelous student from El Salvador who I gave my lecture, passed out King Lear and said, "Don't read it." She came back on Monday morning and she said, "My cousin and I read this play over the weekend and I have some questions." I said, "Honey, there's nobody in the world who doesn't have questions about King Lear. Why did you read it?" No. Anyway, it was, you know, if you tell a kid not to read it, of course they're going to go home and read it. But I would say if you insist on reading it, read it aloud with a friend. And that would help a little bit. But I never, ever, ever made a student read an entire play in my English class, ever. And I think that's a terrible thing to do because it kills Shakespeare. And people who try to read a play in 10th grade, they'll never pick it up again. And taking them to Shakespeare, that's another thing. I would always go see the play first because there are some really, really bad Shakespeare, you know, productions. And that's another thing that kills Shakespeare. If you see one great, great, vibrant, intelligible, stimulating, energetic Shakespeare play, you'll never go back. You'll be sold. And right. So those students have never had that experience, and it's a very sad thing. And even in England, that's true. Even in England, I know English people who I admire and love, and I consider them highly intelligent, who are completely bored by Shakespeare. Mm. I mean, it's not hard for me to figure out why, because I have seen some really, really rotten productions.
Well, it's almost like opera. I think I spent the first 30-something years of my life not having any idea why people listen to opera. How did this thing survive opera?
Yeah.
And one experience sort of opened the doors to opera and go, oh, this is amazing.
Yeah.
And I likened that to Shakespeare. And it's funny because I had the benefit of having you as my mother and pushing Shakespeare on us, taking me to Shakespeare. And even with that, I think I saw a dozen productions before I started to get Shakespeare.
Yeah.
It took me a long time. I remember just rolling my eyes. Oh God, you gotta go.
Well, like I was starting to say earlier, I started watching, I mean, my first experience with Shakespeare, as I say in my book, was when I was 4 years old, I opened the refrigerator and saw my father's head covered with blood in a bed of lettuce. And I was just paralyzed, and my mother came running over and said, "Honey, it's a prop, it's a prop." He was playing Macbeth at the time. And this was his, you know,
Macbeth gets his head shot.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So they bring him on, you know. And so that was my earliest experience. But my earliest experience seeing a whole season was when I was 7 years old. And like it completely went over my head, except for the funny people. The mechanicals, the locals, the clowns, the women, the sassy, sharp-tongued women, those were the characters I fell in love with. I mean, I was just smitten from the very beginning with the comic characters. And when I started reading Erasmus's colloquies, Erasmus wrote these colloquies in Latin 40 years before Shakespeare was born. But Shakespeare was reading them in Latin and performing them in Latin in his Latin grammar school. And I started reading them and I thought, oh, has nobody ever read these things? They're totally, totally Shakespearean. They're the comic characters that Shakespeare incorporated into his imagination that show up in Bardolph and Nym and Mistress Quickly and Doll Tearsheet and Falstaff. They're all in Erasmus's colloquies from 40 years before Shakespeare was even born. And I thought, nobody's ever noticed this. So that's what led me to write the book. And then the other thing that I incorporated into it was two workshops I did with a fantastic man named Milan Dragicevich, who's a professor at UMass in Amherst. And he used to be at UCLA. And I did a couple of workshops. I hired him to do some workshops with my teachers in LA Unified and my drama teachers. And he turned me on to the powerful, propulsive thrill of rhetorical language. So combining the rhetoric, the rhetorical English, with the conversational English of Erasmus's colloquies, just came together that this was the birth of Shakespeare's genius. And it was so obvious to me. And I don't know anybody else in the world who has read all of Erasmus's colloquies. Even T.W. Baldwin didn't read them all. And T.W. Baldwin, in case you didn't know, wrote the two huge, huge tomes in the 40s about Shakespeare's education. So everything about Shakespeare's education, where they bought the books, how the teachers, everything is in there, except for he has one chapter about the use of colloquies to teach conversational language. Latin. And he says, somebody should look more closely at those of Erasmus.
That's you.
Well, I just did.
So what would you say to somebody who says that your enthusiasm for this connection between Erasmus's colloquies and the plays of Shakespeare is getting the best of your academic side, and that
I'm not an academic. I am not an academic. I'm a practitioner. I was a high school teacher and drama teacher, English and drama. I'm not an academic. And I've never been an academic.
But you make the claim that these colloquies were performed by Shakespeare.
As a child in Latin.
And you draw connections between characters in the colloquies and characters in Shakespeare's play.
Yes.
So is that just speculative or
no?
How confident are you?
I'm totally confident because we have the receipts. These colloquies, these collections of colloquies were published again and again and again, and most of them were sold in England to the Latin grammar schools. They were in every single Latin grammar school. They were in the statutes of a great many of them, about two-thirds of them or three-quarters of them have them, actually have like Thursday and Friday from 10 to 11, Erasmus's colloquies. And where they don't appear, it doesn't mean that they weren't taught. It just means they were, because they were colloquial language and not rhetorical language, they weren't as highly prized. They weren't the Ovid and the Cicero and the mm-hmm. and the Virgil and all it, you know, the classical literature that they read. They were colloquial.
And just to
But we know from the receipts that hundreds and thousands of them were sold in England. And they weren't sold to people who were, you know, casually read. They were sold to schools.
As a means of teaching Latin.
Exactly. A conversational Latin. Now, this is a very important distinction to make. Back then, Latin was a living language. If you wanted to go into the trades in Europe, or if you wanted to be a priest or a lawyer or a courtier, you had to know Latin. Latin was the lingua franca. You went to Spain or Italy or Portugal, and you spoke to your peers in Latin because you couldn't learn all those languages. So the language you learned was Latin.
And so the colloquies was a fun way of learning Latin.
Yeah.
You have to learn Latin. You have to learn Latin. You're going to have to speak it.
Yeah, drinking party Latin.
So let's have fun and let's do these plays to practice speaking Latin.
Yes.
So give me an example of what you would say is sort of a one-to-one connection between something you'd find in the colloquies and something that you would find in one of Shakespeare's plays.
Well, the one that leaps out at me is one called Naufragium, which means shipwreck. And now we know there are shipwrecks in several of Shakespeare's plays. There's one in Twelfth Night. There's one in The Tempest, of course. There's one in the Comedy of Errors. And in every one of those, there's a character named Antonio. Now, Antonio is one of two speakers in a colloquy that he wrote in the
Erasmus.
That Erasmus wrote in the 1520s called Naufragium, which means shipwreck. And in that colloquy, there are two. One that's been noticed by a few scholars is at the very beginning, there's a description of St. Elmo's fire. And when Ariel is describing
St. Elmo's fire?
St. Elmo's fire is a phenomenon that happens at sea.
Okay.
I don't know what causes it, but fire seems to light up
the
ship masts and roll down. It's not real fire.
Right.
It's just the illusion of fire.
Okay.
But it's called St. Elmo's fire, and it's a weather phenomenon that happens.
Okay.
And Ariel describes St. Elmo's fire in the first act of The Tempest.
Okay.
And there's a description of St. Elmo's fire in Naufragium, which is, I mean, it's not word for word because it's in translation. It's in Latin, but it's vision for vision. Mm. It rolls down the mast and across the sea. That a few scholars have noticed.
Mm.
What I have not found any scholar that's noticed another one, which is that when the ship starts to sink and everybody in Naufragium, everybody's running around. And, oh, by the way, Naufragium was based on a real shipwreck, a merchant ship that was sailing from Holland to Italy, or from England, I think it was actually Scotland to Italy, sank off the coast of Holland.
Mm.
And it was within sight of shore.
Okay.
And a lot of people escaped. I mean, a lot of people were able to, you know, back then not everybody could swim, but a lot of people were able to make it to shore, but many, many, many drowned. There was in the colloquies, there's a story of a woman who, when everybody was racing around in a panic, she was nursing a child, and some sailors found a mast, and they tied her to the mast and gave her a board, one of the, you know, boards that they pulled off the boat to row with. So she held her baby in one hand and rowed herself to shore with the other. She was always calm. She just rowed herself to shore, saved herself and a baby, and the baby, and it's in the colloquy. Mm. Now, there are two scenes in Shakespeare in which there's a shipwreck and a baby, or two babies in the case of Comedy of Errors, are rowed to shore. Or in the Comedy of Errors, it's two babies, you know, the twins. There's two twins and they get separated, but the mother, the one mother, and the, anyway, there's two people who carry two twins on a mast and row them to shore. And then, of course, in Twelfth Night, what's his name? I've forgotten the name, but I'm sorry. But there's Viola's brother rows himself to shore in a ship, after a shipwreck. So it appears twice in Shakespeare's imagination. Where did it come from? When he read it at Stratford Grammar School, he was probably 10 or 11 years old, and he had a lot of little siblings. So he probably had a mother at home nursing a baby or having recently nursed a baby. And this made a vivid impression on him, a woman nursing a baby, saving herself in a shipwreck. And it appears twice in his plays. Now, I don't think that's a coincidence. I really don't. Then there's a lot of other scenes that I could go on and on, but we'll stop at that one.
Okay, well, one thing that your book touches on, which I think is distinct from other books on the subject of Shakespeare's education, you're not just focused on Shakespeare. You're focused on the audiences of Shakespeare and how this theater-loving generation emerged. I wonder if you could talk about the education system in broad terms of the Renaissance in England that gave rise both to Shakespeare and the and Shakespeare's audience and the audiences of Shakespeare and Marlowe and Ben Jonson and the other playwrights at the time.
Okay, well that's a big conversation. Okay. I'll just dive in. First of all, the education at the time was only for boys, and mainly for boys of property. Although, you know, tradesmen's sons who showed great promise, like Marlowe, for instance, and Ben Jonson, would go to these Latin grammar schools. You know, gifted program. But it was only for boys and property or gifted boys. No women, no girls. And it was in Latin. It was entirely in Latin. So how does that translate to English? They're trained in rhetoric in Latin. But what was happening at the time, and Mulcaster,
Richard Mulcaster,
Shakespeare's teacher, Thomas Jenkins, was taught by Richard Mulcaster at the Merchant Taylor School in London.
And so he was like the headmaster of the headmasters.
Yes. And both of the headmasters while Shakespeare was at Stratford, Thomas Jenkins and John Cottam, but John Cottam didn't take over till Shakespeare was 16. And so if he was exposed to him, he was probably either the headmaster for one of his siblings, or he may have been a praepositor. That sometimes a student for the last year would become an assistant, basically an assistant teacher. So there is reference to Shakespeare teaching in the country. It may have been because he was a praepositor in Stratford under John Cottam. So, but he certainly knew John Cottam. So Thomas Jenkins, John Cottam were both trained by Richard Mulcaster at the Merchant Taylor School in London. So there's a direct connection there. Okay, where were we?
The education of the time.
It was all for boys, but what was happening between 1580 and 1620.
40 years.
40 years. And I can't remember the name. I'm sorry, I don't have my book in front of me, but there was a period of time before 1580, the only things written in English were comic plays for popular audiences, street plays. And there were books of romantic poetry that were devoured by people learning to be courtiers. But there really was no great literature before Spenser written in English.
Spenser the playwright?
Spenser the poet.
Okay.
Yeah. Who was, by the way, a student of Richard Mulcaster. Spenser was the first great poet. You could say, I've forgotten the name, there's another one. Somebody could argue with me on this. There was somebody else, but he was better known as a consort to Anne Boleyn. What was his name? I can't remember. Next time we do this, I'll remember.
Okay.
But the first great poet who wrote in English was Spenser, who was a student of Mulcaster. And Mulcaster, in his books, Positions in Elementary, gave voice to, I mean, his books are really hard to read because they're so snarly. But he was an incredibly prescient thinker. And he foresaw a time when education would not be in Latin, it would be in English, because he loved English and he saw the power of it. Now, I can't say that he was the only one. He certainly wasn't the only one. The Earl of Leicester was giving out commissions to people to translate the Latin classics into English. He was, there was a lot of enthusiasm boiling around under the surface in the early 80s, 1580s, for English.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Shakespeare comes along, and I think he came along, you know, in the mid 80s. And at that time, most plays were done, well, this is a long story, but the men's companies were just emerging.
Mm-hmm.
They had the support of the Queen, and the men's companies were coming more and more and more popular, and the writers for the men's companies were more and more popular. And Shakespeare was an actor at first, but he was a playmaker. He wasn't called a playwright. He was called a playmaker. He learned that skill in grammar school. I'm certain of it. I'm certain that the first version of Taming the Shrew was written by a bunch of boys at Stratford Grammar School. I'm absolutely certain, because there's a colloquy. There's the Taming the Shrew. Xanthippe, the shrew, is in a colloquy. And it's a funny, funny, funny colloquy. And there's also one with Grumio, also from Taming the Shrew. They're different names, but there's two colloquies that make their way. I mean, they could literally, you could take them word for word and put them into Taming the Shrew, and you wouldn't even notice that it was a different, you know, language. They're so perfectly matched. So obviously he performed it in, he probably wrote his first version of Taming the Shrew when he was a student, I think. That's my opinion. You could argue with me. But he came to London already an accomplished playwright, I think. There's an version, what they call an U-R version of Taming the Shrew, which came earlier. I'm certain that it was from Shakespeare's pen. He probably did it in collaboration with other writers, because that's the way they did things. They were actors, and they were writing out the plays as they acted. More, you know, the later plays, I think, are almost entirely by Shakespeare's pen. But the early plays were definitely included collaboration, especially the comic scenes. So that's, he doesn't appear on the stage until 1593, the famous Upstart Crow speech where they referred to him, but I'm sure that he'd been in London for at least 4, 5, 6 years as a playmaker, as a play fixer, and an actor. And The Taming of the Shrew came out of that era, as did Comedy of Errors, and, you know, a number of, and, you know, a couple of the others.
Well, so, you know, you paint a picture of the Globe Theater and the theater world at that time. You describe visiting the Globe Theater and saying that at its capacity, it could seat maybe 2,000 people could be there at one time.
That's what they told me.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I could imagine it. They would be stuffed in like sardines. Mm-hmm. But the thing about it, because it's a cylinder,
right,
you could see every face and you could hear every word. I mean, we actually, on when I was there for a program for American English teachers, and we would have our time on the Globe at 7 o'clock in the morning before the actors came to rehearse. We'd have 2 hours. And so we spent a lot of time on the Globe stage, and I learned a lot about the Globe stage. I learned that I had always thought there were certain points where an actor would go, where the sound would resonate.
Mm-hmm.
No, it resonated everywhere, and you could be sitting. We would seat ourselves all around, up, down, and everywhere, and we could hear every word of a male actor speaking. Women's voices had to be projected a little more forcefully, but a trained male voice, you could hear every word. You didn't need any amplification.
Well, even with the acoustics.
Anywhere on the stage, by the way, anywhere on the stage.
But even with the acoustics, you would imagine that the audience was listening, that there was a kind of focus and attention. And in Shakespeare's plays, there's this just elevation of language. It reaches this very just fine apotheosis of eloquence. So two questions. How was listening taught, and how was eloquence taught? If you don't mind, I can read a passage from your book.
Mm-hmm.
So you say something. You write that the goal of all this reading and writing and performing in school was the formation of, quote unquote, gentlemen, able to engage in civil society with eloquence. Eloquence was authority, eloquence was power, and eloquence was attained through the rigorous study and practice of the art of rhetoric in writing, in speaking, and in acting. So this emphasis on eloquence is like this supreme value. And the audience sort of geared towards that. That there's sort of a pressure towards that. That's the sense that I get. Can you speak upon that eloquence as a value and how it was practiced in school?
Well, to begin with, you know that in those days you didn't say you went to see a play. You always said you went to hear a play. Hearing was elevated above seeing in theater. Now, where does that come from? First of all, Shakespeare was educated less than a century after the printing press. And books were still very, very expensive. I mean, there were certainly books. There were booksellers. There were many, many books in print, but they were very expensive. If you had a book, you passed it on to generation to generation. Schools did not have libraries. There were no libraries. You had your tables, which was a notebook like this, on your lap, and you were writing down the speeches, the words you had to memorize from Ovid or whatever. And you wrote down, you had columns for various parts of speech, and you had your notebooks were your education, your written education. So memorizing was a constant. Students had to memorize, I think, about something like 18 lines of poetry a week. And it was very, very, and they were constantly, if you look at the woodcuts from the time, they were constantly performing before either a teacher or an usher, the headmaster, or an usher who was an assistant teacher, or a prepositor, which was a student teacher, or an older student. They were constantly having to recite their lessons. And you didn't just recite it, you had to act it out, actio. Rhetoric really originally was about spoken language. The rhetor was a speaker. Many rhetors didn't even know how to read. They were speakers. So when you talk about rhetoric, the roots of rhetoric are in spoken language, not in written language. And when I talk about the roots, all the way back to ancient Greece, 400 BC, the rhetor was very, very powerful because it was a pre-literate society. So the person who could persuade had enormous amount of power, for good or evil. There were a lot of people who used it to ill effect. But it was a powerful, powerful skill. Speaking was a powerful skill. And Shakespeare was early in the printed literature world, but it was very early. He didn't have a lot of books. He had to memorize and memorize and memorize those. It was the constant, Erasmus talks about the constant tedium of memorization. So how did I get here?
We're talking about the audience.
Had to hear
the
it.
The audience for Shakespeare's play.
Yeah, so you had to recite, you had to perform it, using your gestures, your voice, your pacing, all of the skills of the acting. It was called actio. Actio was a major. Demosthenes talked about the principal part of an oration is actio. The most important thing in an oration is actio. The second most important is actio. The third most important is actio. 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 Actio.
Actio is everything.
You had to be acting. Every time you got up to speak, you were acting. So it wasn't just memorizing, it was acting all the time, every day. So there was an enormous amount of emphasis on that.
Do you think that is still true today?
No.
Well, you don't think that the ability to be eloquent with your language is immensely powerful and immensely important? Or you just don't think it holds nearly the same amount of importance as it did at that time?
It doesn't hold any importance except in a drama class. And I gave the example, think about, I forgot her name, but the kids after Parkland who went out the girl who spoke
in
half a million people.
Head.
Yeah, what was her name? Sorry. Old lady, no brain. Those kids were drama students.
Right, but they were powerful.
Drama students are powerful.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Do you
think it has power in relevance?
Oh, yes. Yeah. And the only place where you get it now is in a drama class. And that's the point of my book. If everybody were trained in drama, we would have much, much more intelligent, powerful thinkers.
Yeah.
It's
funny because to look at politics over the last 20 years or so, like, Obama was praised for being eloquent and well-spoken. Bush and Trump were not. And yet, I feel that in some ways, both Bush and Trump had power in the way that they spoke that was persuasive. And by dismissing them as buffoons, we were not acknowledging the particular rhetorical skills that
exactly,
they did have.
Exactly, exactly. And rhetoric is a very, 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 can be a very dangerous tool. So.
Are there characters in Shakespeare that use rhetoric to ill intent, as you say, or?
Iago. I mean, yeah.
What is Iago? How does Iago use his skills of
rhetoric?
Honey,
you're asking me to memorize, to speak. Iago speaks. He's an incredibly eloquent speaker. And not just Iago. I mean, think of all the villains. You know.
They use their language to sort of webs.
Richard III, my God. Beautiful, beautiful speeches.
He's a villain.
Yeah, Richard III is a villain. He's a hunchback villain. Persuasive. He talks the wife of a man he's murdered into marrying him using his eloquence. Top that, you know.
Thank you so much for joining us. Please be sure to join us next week when we explore exactly how William Shakespeare learned the art of rhetoric.